I am thinking at him as hard as I can, but he just won't perish.
Hello everyone and welcome. Today I answer the question, can you beat Elden Ring with telekinesis?
So, what does that even mean? Well, if you had an image of me intensely staring down at my controller until it started to move on its own, sorry, that's not what happened, but man, that would be cool.
Instead, there are several weapons, or more specifically, Ash of Wars in this game that see the character control the weapon with their mind. And that's it. My character is going to control a sword with their mind.
What's that? Basically an Ash of War run and I've already done those?
Don't know what you're talking about. Anyway, the first part of the run is always the same. Go around collecting seeds and tears, but you might have noticed an issue. None of the starting classes have the ability to throw a sword with their mind, or even with their muscles for that matter, so I need to find a weapon that is accessible right now that also doesn't require fighting anything. In my research, I was able to find three weapons and one Ash of War that lets me channel my inner Mewtwo, but sadly, all four of those are locked behind at least one boss. Sort of. I mean, it's not a wrong statement. You are intended to fight at least one enemy before claiming your prize, but what's a FromSoft game without a little cheese? Over near the Third Church of America, you can do a little, very unintended jumping to get the regalia of AOK'd early. Ignore those runes, I totally did this on my first try. Anyway, the jumping pattern isn't super straightforward, but it's also pretty easy once you know where to actually land, so for anyone wanting this weapon early without fighting the frenzied duelist inside, just follow this pattern and you'll be fine. Alright, weapon collected. I can't use it. It requires more strength, dex, and arcane than I currently have. The first two can easily be fixed with Radagon Sword Seal. Unfortunately, that means I still don't have the arcane to use it. Excuse me? Yeah, so I totally thought the Ash of War would be unusable unless I met all of the stat requirements. I don't understand this game sometimes. Well, I guess let's test it out. Hey Jeff, hold still for a second. Oh no, that is not a lot of damage. I sure hope that's just me not meeting the stat requirement and not this Ash of War actually being that bad.
Well, only one way to find out. I grabbed a few poppables while running around so I can just use those to get my arcane up.
Oh good, that is a much more respectable amount of damage. I'm sure glad I dodged that bullet, unlike Jeff here who didn't dodge anything. Since the condition of have weapon is now equal to true, that means it's time for Margit.
I sometimes like to do this fight without any upgrades, but I have a feeling it just won't be possible to completely base everything, so I upgrade my flash to a +5 and make sure to have some backup blues. So, let's talk about AOK's Dancing Blade. It's a chargeable multi-hit attack that ends in a sword slash. But I am the mini stupid and didn't actually realize there was a charged and uncharged version until later. I kinda just held the button down thinking harder button press means more damage. Which, to be fair, I guess in this case isn't technically wrong, but it absolutely made this fight harder than it should have been. Anyway, that's something I'll talk about a little later when I actually realized it. For now, back to what the sword can do. The first part of the attack is a stabbing corkscrew-like animation where the sword hits 9-ish times? The final hit doing an increased amount of damage, then is followed up by a sword swing that does an equal amount of damage. In other words, if only the first few attacks connect, it does very little, but if the whole combo lands, it's... well, right now also not very much damage, but I've been here before. I have a sneaking suspicion that with the right build, this attack will be disgustingly powerful. And let's hope I'm right, because right now Margit is, he's kinda kicking my ass. One of the issues I found was that the charging animation was so long, he would occasionally just jump away before either of the big hits went off, so I ended up doing next to nothing at the cost of using a finite amount of FP. Meaning, if he did that too much, I would just lose by default. Ah. Now I see why this game is called Dark Souls 2, too. Okay, so that attempt was, kinda close, but I'm thinking it would be smarter to upgrade this weapon first. So I grab a Somber 1 and 2 from the Weeping Peninsula. I also use all the runes I have to level up Vigor. It would be nice to outlevel the need for the Sword Seal to stop taking increased damage, but for such an early game boss, it probably doesn't matter. I then take on the Guardian Golem, both to test out my damage and for the Blue Dancer Charm. Unfortunately, I am not able to equip it yet, but it'll be useful soon. I did make a very important discovery during this fight. No, it's not that you don't have to charge the attack every time, it's that the final two hits are actually separate animations. Meaning, you can cancel into a roll after the first one, making this attack slightly less committal and, far more importantly, slightly faster. Armed with my new strength and knowledge, I take on Margit again. The damage is better, but there is still hardly ever a chance to safely attack him. Occasionally, I get in a full charge, but that's heavily dependent on how he follows up, or in most cases, how he just doesn't follow up. When phase 2 starts, it gets even worse. Normally, there's a small window to attack after he does his hammer slam, but here, yeah, no, not so much. Okay, remember what I just said about low vigor being okay? Well, throw that out the window. This seal needs to come off now. I grab some high-level poppable runes from Kaelid and have just enough to get the minimum stats to use my sword, then throw on the Blue Dancer Charm and get completely naked to assert dominance, and also remove all my armor to maximize the talisman's effect. Now I'm doing almost twice as much damage as my initial encounter with him, which is fantastic. It was pretty close, but in the end, a naked tarnished with a sword always wins.
Next up is Godric, and I had just assumed this fight would be so easy that I went ahead and re-equipped the Sword Seal just for the extra damage numbers, but let me tell you, I was absolutely right. So I am still occasionally face tanking attacks, that's probably just going to be a theme of this run, but Godric here doesn't move anywhere near as fast as Margit, meaning when he does hit me, it's usually just one attack instead of some hyper aggressive combo. It's even more apparent after he grafts the dragon to his hand as several of his breath attacks leave him open long enough for a fully charged dancing blade, and his ground pound that's now 3 hits instead of 2 has a cooldown just long enough to also be a safe window. Translation, Godric easy, but I guess what else is new? I did actually miss something important in Godric's castle, but thankfully I can go to Roundtable Hold to buy it from Rajir. Spinning Weapon. This very aptly named Ash of War does exactly what it says on the tin. It spins the weapon. It doesn't seem to do as much overall damage as Dancing Blade does, but it costs slightly less FP, and I can put it on a large variety of weapons, which might be helpful when combined with a few status effects. Maybe. I didn't test that a lot. Be sure to tell me down in the comments below how I could have put this on a specific weapon and it would have absolutely obliterated boss health bars, and while you're down there, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe, it really helps the channel out. Ah, Liurnia. You know, I don't know if this is a controversial opinion or not, but it's probably my least favorite section of the game. I mean, it's big, like, a little too big, and it feels empty. I know there are field bosses in mini dungeons everywhere, but it just feels like there's nothing there due to its sheer size. Ah well, I leveled my weapon to a +4, then head into Stillwater Cave for the Winged Sword Insignia. For those of you that don't know, this talisman increases attack power in tiers with successive attacks. The first tier is 3%, then 5, then 10. In other words, this talisman is tailor-made for fast weapons like dual daggers. And unintentionally fantastic for Aok's Dancing Blade, because yes, every damaging tick from Dancing Blade counts as a separate attack. So basically, this talisman is just a 10% increase in damage considering it's my only means of attacking. Alright, time to take on the Academy. Huh, I guess the Dark Souls 2 hitboxes worked in my favor this time. So the Red Wolf. I was worried because he's fast, he likes to jump around a lot, and since this blade will attack directly in front of me, if he moves just a little to the side, it'll miss. First attempt? Yeah, not so great. But this is where I realized you don't have to charge the attack fully, and it was actually a game changer. Being able to get the attack out quickly and dodge between the two final hits actually made a massive difference throughout this run. There are two drawbacks. The obvious one is that it does less damage, but it also has much less range. It feels like the sword gets thrown about half as far, but for having the attack time, I'll take it. As great as this realization is, it's ironically not useful for Rennala as she's mostly stationary anyway, or in the case of Phase 1, completely stationary while I attack her. I use Spinning Weapon to hit the Sweetings because any damage will break the shield, and I gotta save that whole 2 FP just in case. Also, I'm very disappointed this move doesn't reflect the books like some kind of fan force field. Anyway, the actual damage to her is, well, honestly kinda mid. I mean, it looks good, but the problem is just by eyeballing it, I'm gonna guess it's a 3 cycle. Normally that's not a huge issue, but the problem is that 6 casts of Dancing Blade plus 9 spinning weapons at least. Fortunately, I made sure to bring plenty of blue Gatorade to rehydrate before Phase 2, and I'm sure glad I did because here I just keep throwing her to the ground and drilling her over and over. No, wait, YouTube, I just meant that I was thrusting my sword repeatedly into the hot single mom in my area. No, wait! After demonetization the boss goes down, I make my way to Altus Plateau where I take on the Crystallions. You might be wondering why I'm fighting them. Well, I just thought it would be really cool to hit two bosses at once with this ability, and definitely not because I forgot which bell bearing they dropped. Joking aside, they dropped the Somber bell bearing too, which I thought allowed you to purchase a Somber 5, but I was just wrong. Still, this will allow an infinite amount of 3s and 4s for my other two weapons. Which, now that I'm saying that out loud, I realize how stupid that is because you only need one Somber Stone per upgrade level, and if I only have two more weapons, I could just get them from EG. Conclusion, Doom is dumb. Anyway, I do know that there is a 5 in Volcano Manor, as well as a 6 in Mount Gilmere, so I just grab those instead. Then, I go test out my newfound strength on the Draconic Tree Symbol. Yep, that's what I expected to happen. So the first problem is actually finding a safe window to attack. One thing that can work is baiting a couple of his Shield Slam attacks. It requires good positioning, but since the fully charged version of Dancing Blade has some pretty decent distance, it's not so bad. But the better option I quickly found is to simply dodge to his shield side on a fireball and do an uncharged attack, making sure to roll away after the first set of hits. This was working pretty well, but I still just didn't have enough damage to outpace my mistakes. So I made a stop to get the Ritual Sword Talisman, then I decided to put some armor back on in an attempt to not take as much damage from literally everything. Did it make a difference? No, not really. I threw myself at DTS a few more times hoping to succeed, but to no avail. He's definitely doable right now, but I just didn't want to keep trying in vain when there are other ways to make myself stronger first. So, instead of banging my head against that wall, I'll bang my head against this wall instead. Commander O'Neill starts off pretty strong. Since I can sneak up behind him and he will always start the fight by summoning, I can get in 3 fully charged attacks before he can do anything, and on the 3rd one he'll actually get staggered. Unfortunately, by that point his summons are already up and out for blood, which when combined with my lack of spatial awareness and panic rolling made my first attempt end not so great. Second attempt went better because I backed off and handled his summons, but now the problem was with the timings of his attacks. See, the commander swings pretty slow. In fact, with a fast weapon like a dagger, you can easily weave your own between his. But I'm not using a fast weapon, meaning I have to wait for his combos to be done. So far sounds normal, right? Except my attack also has a weird timing, and basically when these two things are combined, it becomes extremely difficult to successfully hit him while maintaining the original composition of my face. This fight seems a little less doable than DTS currently, but fortunately I still have a couple more cards up my sleeve, and no, I don't mean cheesing him with the rock geysers. So first, I head into Celia Crystal Tunnel to take on the Falling Star Beast. It'll give me a few extra runes, but mostly I just wanted a somber 6. Then I go grab a 5 from Altus Tunnel, meaning, should I have another weapon, I can make it a plus 6. And oh would ya, look at that, it's about new weapon o'clock, so I head north to the Shaded Castle. I make sure to grab the Valkyrie's prosthesis before heading into the boss room. Sir, you have a weapon I would like, and you can either give it to me now, or we can do this the hard way. Listen, I'm going to give you a second chance to think this over. Well, you know what they say, third time's a charm. Yeah, I am not familiar with this boss, like hardly at all. I think including the bell-bearing hunters, I've only fought him maybe 5 times, which apparently definitely isn't enough. Anyway, the absolute safest time I found to attack was when he would try the corkscrew. So much so, it was actually incredibly easy to just run behind him and get a full charge off. After that, the shield slam works, some of the time. Never if he did the explosion, but if it was just the slam, it would depend on his follow-up and my timing to actually align the dodges correctly. Eventually, though, he goes down and finally relinquishes... Bigger Regalia of AOK to me. So, I know that I'm making a joke about this just being a bigger version of my sword, but for this run, that's exactly what it is. The Ash of War is exactly the same, like not similar, they are actually the same ability. And since the damage scales off of the attack rating, the Executioner Sword is literally just a direct upgrade. But it also has a higher stat requirements, and that is where my new problem is. See, I didn't plan on getting this sword so early, I wanted to space it out further for a better sense of power progression. As such, I didn't have the necessary stats to wield it. So now I have 2 options. I can either run around collecting runes and fighting easy bosses to level up, or I could just go back and throw myself at the Draconic Tree Sentinel some more. Yeah, we both know which one I picked. When the fight starts, it's possible to get 2 fully charged attacks off. This is a little spacing dependent, because if you're too close, he'll just jump away, so be careful. After the second corkscrew, he'll do a little mini stagger, which lasts just long enough to allow for a follow-up swing and a dodge. At this point, just go for a third charge attack because it'll stagger him, however, it'll immediately knock him out of the stagger, which sounds bad, except because it was a fully charged attack, he will again get a mini stagger after the corkscrew, then you can just follow up and dodge. So that's an easy way to lob off a 1/4 of his health before the fight actually begins. After this though, it's as easy as dodging the short range fireball to his shield side, uncharged attack, then mash dodge backwards. An unexpected opening I found was in phase 2, his lightning strike ability also has enough time after it for an uncharged attack, so that's neat. Still takes me a few tries because he hits like an absolute freight train, but eventually he goes down and gives me just enough runes to be able to use my shiny new sword. Since this is definitely my in-game weapon, I figured why not just start working to become overpowered right now. Also, I thought about using the Briar Armor just to go with it, but I was worried I'd accidentally roll into an enemy and invalidate the run, you know, because that whole 2 damage would have made a difference in the end. Anyway, in the sewers, I grab Moke Shackle and a Somber 7, then from Kaelid an 8 and a 9.
Wow, it really looks like he fell for me.
Okay, it is time to test out my weapon. Let me just pin old Goat Ghost over here to see the maximum effect. Yep, it is the strong. Funnily enough, the weird offbeat swings Moog has perfectly complement this weapon art. In fact, I only got hit twice throughout the fight, and both times were because I took a risk of a follow-up swing, which is great news for later. I honestly didn't think real Moog would be a problem, but it is nice to have confirmation. Back above ground, I make my way to see Goldfree. Well, that was rude. Honestly, the nerve of some enemies to try and attack me at range. I guess screaming beats telekinesis. Speaking of glimpses into the future, Yellow Chadfree here isn't an issue. The game doesn't expect the player to have a nearly maxed weapon right now, so he just kind of melts. There's even a few safe windows to attack, most notably after he spins around to slam his axe down. Either way, he goes down first try.
Not gonna lie, I was a little worried about Morgott considering how badly Margit kicked my ass, so I decided to go even further beyond with this build. Sneaking up behind the commander again, but this time with a much bigger sword allows me to chunk off, well, a lot of damage. Like, had he not summoned anything, the fight might have just ended right here. I'm still not completely sure when it's safe to hit the commander. In this case, I can easily brute force it, but that's probably not gonna work for the other version of it. However, I did notice right at the end I poised through an attack. I'm not wearing the sturdiest of armor, so that has to come from the Ash of War, I assume. Either way, I let O'Neill Cool Guy walk into my sword, then do the gallery quest line to help objectively best girl Millicent. Since I already picked up the Valkyrie's prosthesis, I can just give it to her immediately to advance a questline, then head over to Windmill Village to take on the Godskin Apostle. Honestly, I hadn't really thought of a plan for the duo yet. I tend to block their existence out of my mind until absolutely necessary, so this will be a good trial for when I can attack him. I can face tank the helicopter attack, which is fine here, but when there is something else in the room wanting to turn me into a pancake, it probably isn't worth it to try. And unfortunately, I didn't actually learn anything because I kinda melted his health bar. Which is a weird thing to complain about, right? I killed this boss too fast. Anyway, I then summon best waifu Millicent, and this is where I enter the dark timeline. See, Millicent here has something I want. In fact, she has two somethings I want, and no, get your head out of the gutter, she's not Guinevere. I'm gonna have to rename this video Challenge Runner Simps for Souls Girls, aren't I? The two things she has are Millicent's prosthesis and the Rotten Wing sword insignia, but I can't get both of those in a single playthrough, so I have to decide which one I want. The latter is just a direct upgrade to the regular wing sword insignia, but the former behaves the same way, while boosting dexterity, and most importantly, stacks with either of the wing sword insignias. Both of these can be rewarded for finishing her questline. Or, if she dies from this point on, the prosthesis is dropped, so I'm sorry, Millicent, I really am. I always wanted to drill you, just not like this. Welp, dead is dead, so I throw on that talisman, then make my way back to Morgott. Here it is, the battle of the ages, the rivalry to end all rivalries. I was ready to go toe-to-toe with him, slowly whittling down his health, dying and trying over and over again. Except that's not what happened because this sword is broken. I didn't even have to try and wait for an opening. I mean, sure, that's the smart thing, but because I can poise through a few smaller hits, I can easily tank a dagger slash then roll away when I needed to. In the end, Morgott fell on the first try. Anticlimactic, I know. Also, why is it that after Morgott is defeated, he turns into, like, a prune? I mean, I've done some challenge runs that took forever, but this wasn't one of them, and he definitely didn't die of old age here. Whatever, here I decided to make a calculated decision to go after the strongest demigod of the Shattering, General Radahn. Except in this run, that name is an absolute lie. Look at that damage, about a quarter of his health with one attack. I wish I could say more, but this was another case of am so overleveled, nothing matters. But anyway, the reason I actually came to do him now, specifically before the Fire Giant, was for Alexander. Or rather, to make sure I didn't mess up his questline. Killing him here would award the Warrior Jar Shard, which is a 10% increase to Ash of Wars, but finishing his questline gives the Shard of Alexander, which is the same thing, except 15%. Since I'm not struggling to down any bosses now, it's better to just wait for the extra damage. So to that end, I also meet up with him at the famous Mount Gilmer Sauna, where he tells me he's headed to the Forge of the Giants, but that's not where I'm going, so it'll have to wait. No, see, I want to go get even stronger, so I head back to Liurnia to talk to Old Man Dumbledore for half the secret medallion, then head up north to fight Nile. When the fight starts, I wanted to try and hit both the summon and the boss at the same time, but unfortunately the rain just isn't enough and I almost paid for it. I didn't know how this fight would go considering I never found a truly safe opening with O'Neill, and Nile hits a little harder so I couldn't just throw myself at him. Fortunately, when he goes all big frozen Beyblade on me, there's plenty of time to lay on the damage and more importantly time to build up a poise break, which of course allows for even more damage. In the end, it was getting close. I was out of heals and getting hit at least once per attack, but I kind of manipulated him to only ever hit me with the butt of his weapon so it would do less damage. I also admit I got really lucky with some definitely not Dark Souls 2 hitboxes and I ducked under his spear, but hey, we take those. With him down, I have access to the Consecrated Snowfield, and there are two items here that I want. First is from Anastasia. On this invasion, she will drop a Somber Ancient Dragonstone. There are several of them in the game, but this one is easy to get, and I can live out my fantasy of being a Bell-Bearing Hunter. And now I have lived out being the Dragon Barrel Bell-Bearing Hunter specifically. Okay, the other thing that I want is the Thorny Crack tier, which is dropped from this putrid avatar. And I just want to point out that it is crucially important to be aware of your surroundings. I didn't realize how close I was to the ledge until I was literally standing on it, but I have a really good gaming chair so the avatar didn't stand a chance. Anyway, the Thorny Crack tier is basically a winged sword insignia, but in drink form. Also, this putrid avatar gives 160,000 runes, which is kind of a lot for such an easy boss. Back in Ultis, I entered the Golden Lineage Evergel to beat up totally not copy-pasted Godric Phase 1 for the Godfrey icon. This boosts the power of charged skills and spells. I wasn't 100% sure if it worked on Dancing Blade, but after Jeff so kindly helped me test it, I'm pretty sure it does, and with that, it's finally time to take on the Fire Giant. I was worried about this fight because he has a lot of health, he likes to move around a lot, so maybe not all my attacks would connect, and since this blade doesn't cause any status effects, I couldn't hope for those to chunk off his health. I ended up bringing 9 blue flasks into this fight. Do you want to know how many I used? 1. I used a whopping 1 blue flask for this whole fight. Phase 1, just look at this. I'm running out of ways to say this weapon is broken. This happens kind of a lot, actually. I end up doing some random Ash of War run, and it turns out to be the most broken thing, just like with the Death Ritual Spear. Well, anyway, phase 2, I started by hitting his hands just like normal, but instead of going all volcano on me, he chose to spit fire. Now, originally, I thought to just run away, but in the immortal words of Isshin, hesitation is defeat, so I charged in and proceeded to slash at his inner thigh. Even though he should be taking reduced damage, it really doesn't feel that way. I reposition behind him just in case he decides to roll away, but instead he goes for Flame of the Fell God, but I actually didn't notice because he staggers, and of course that means all I see is blood. Then with a final attack, he goes down on the first try, and I am still not at the maximum potential for this weapon. Well, maybe the duo will be the fight that humbles me. No, they did not. Sure, I was worried at the beginning of the fight because 2 enemies is double trouble, but look at the damage I can do to the Noble. To be fair, that was fully charged, but it also didn't have the follow-up swing. Or what about here when the Apostle tried to summon? That was like 75% of his health bar. In one attack. At this point, all I really had to do was wait for the Noble to try and summon and it was game over. To his credit, an already weakened Noble did survive a fully charged attack. Guess it's that extra defense, but it made literally no difference for the result of this fight. I can't with this weapon, how is this even a challenge anymore? Well, it's not, because now it is time to become the Apex Tarnished. Alexander, old friend, I will give you a warrior's death. Wow, that fight lasted like 1.5 seconds. Was it as good for you as it was for me, Alexander? Alexander? Oh, right. Alexander's Jar Shard will increase weapon skill damage by 15%. I decided to drop the Ritual Sword Talisman because a 10% increase at full health is nice, but a 15% increase at any point is better. Now, I could just go on a rampage destroying all the bosses, and I definitely plan to, but I think I would like to grab the 4th and final weapon I can use. It's housed within the Ariza Hero's Grave. I heard if you use Moog's Shackle, you can break these chariots. Well, that clearly didn't work. Okay, I guess it works, it just takes a second. The boss of this dungeon is the Crucible Knight Duo. Oh joy, and me without a parry. I have defeated this boss exactly 1 time. I know that because after doing so, I basically locked this whole area out of my memory. So, is this fight as hard as I remember? Well, first impressions weren't that great. For most of that attempt, I didn't get any solid hits in, it was just a lot of chip damage. But for the second encounter, I did this. So yeah, baby easy mode boss. Anyway, this awards me with Ordovus' Greatsword, a split faith strength weapon, and this time I was prepared with the necessary levels to wield it. The Ash of War, Ordovus' Vortex, is this neat little wind-up ground slam attack that does a decent amount of damage. The problem right now is that this has next to zero synergy with my current build. However, I do have plans for it, so I'm going to get it set up now. First, in Liurnia, I challenge an Erdtree Avatar with what might as well be a portable woodchipper. This boss drops the Holy Shroud and cracks here. Then, over near Liurnia, Anastasia shows me that she has no fear, even though she definitely should have had at least some fear, and drops a Sacred Scorpion Charm. Both of these items help boost holy damage, which I'm not completely sure if Ordovus' Vortex is holy damage only or if it's split, but either way, it'll help. That's it for now though. I have one very specific use case for the Holy Sword, so it's going in the box until later. Back in Faramazula, I take on Dragon Lord Placidusax, or should I say, Loser Lord Placidurect. Look, I'm just going to show you the amount of damage I did to him after he went into his big laser attack. 2 attacks. Like 7 seconds and I depleted a 1/5 of his health bar. Cool, maybe Malekith will be more of a threat. Now, in phase 1, I wasn't actually sure when to attack. I figured the best chance would be after the big dagger dragon. I was basically right. I mean, I got hit because I charged up to full and caught his backhand, but an uncharged version, especially with an early dodge roll, should be safe. Now, let me show you phase 2. I start by going forwards like always and setting up for a fully charged attack, making sure to lock on for the free tracking. I know he doesn't follow this up with an immediate attack, so I was safe no matter what he did. I just had to react to it. The move I'm looking to bait out is his grounded spinning destined death that sometimes comes after the sweep and slam combo. Fortunately, it's literally the first attack he decides to do against me, and I just... From Software really did Malekith dirty by giving him literal paper for armor. Up next is Gideon, and I thought this was gonna be an easy W. I mean, I've been ripping and tearing my way through bosses like the Doomslayer, so what is one pompous know-it-all gonna do to me? School buses. He's going to throw school buses at me. Then, I also learned that Dancing Blade will absolutely trigger his bubble explosion. Then, I got Stagger Stun locked. Then, he wombo comboed his school buses into an explosion. On my fifth try, however, I found the strat. It is to walk forward and hit L2. No, really, it was literally just abandon any caution and put everything on attack. Well, whatever, like they say, every dog has his day and Gideon's just happened to be today. Moving right along to a fight that actually deserves my attention, Godfrey. Man, I really wish I was good at spacing. So initially, I wanted to bait out the attack where he drags his axe in a circle before slamming it down, but he just never did that attack. I got tired of waiting and just started throwing my sword at him, which honestly worked out pretty well. Phase 2, I played Ring Around the Warrior and stabbed him in the back, doing a massive amount of damage. What I didn't realize is that one attack made him low enough to phase transition, so when he did it, I was miles away. Honestly, had I noticed, I might have been able to finish the fight right there, but it's fine, as long as I don't screw this up. Why am I like this? Whatever, it's fine, I throw caution to the wind and just yeet my sword at him a couple more times until he falls. I can't believe Gideon put up more of a fight than Chadfrey. Or any of the bosses, for that matter. I decided I would handle Ratibees now, even though I had absolutely no worries about the supers, I kinda just wanted the rubies. I'll be honest, I wrote this script about 2 weeks after finishing this run, and I don't remember what happened during the Radagon fight. Like, at all. That's how inconsequential it was. And watching the footage back, yeah, no, that tracks. Same thing goes for Elden Beast. Here, allow me to show you the first 10 seconds of the fight. I run behind him. I throw my sword twice. He's half dead. Unfortunately, what I do remember is that he decided to play keep away the whole time, dragging this out way longer than it should have been, but the difficulty was non-existent. I had zero faith that Elden Beast was going to make some kind of comeback. Sure enough, he falls on the first try and I have beaten Elden Ring with only the powers of my mind. And a massive sword, but that's irrelevant. Down in Nokron, I put my kinetic ability to the test by fighting myself, but that me has the old me's roll patterns, and that me falls to this me because this me throws a sword better than that me. Why did I write this sentence? I head deeper into the Eternal City to grab the Finger Slayer blade. I head north in Liurnia until I get to Caria Manor. I really wanted to make a joke about downing Loretta in one hit, but I missed, so that's embarrassing. Ronnie, I have come here so I can be destined to touch your chest. Wait, that came out wrong. Right, so after that very awkward encounter, I grab the Finger Slayer blade, only to give it over to Lady of Voids by Stairs now, invert the tower, climb to the top, and grab the Curse Mark of Death. You know, I just realized Miyazaki must not have had direct control over the design of Ronnie's real body, because she's missing something pretty important. I can't wait for someone to give me a lore reason as to why she doesn't have any feet. Anyway, I go back through Nokron to take on another crappy duo fight, the Valiant Gargoyles. I will say though, the Gargoyles definitely put up a fight this time. JK, I was leading you all astray with that sentence as this build absolutely melts them. It is kinda hard to connect the attack because they got legs for days, but when it does, boy do they not stand a chance. With access to deep root depths, it's time to take on Fia's champions. I don't know what I expected. Hello Fia, I have come for hugs. Nothing more, nothing less. At first, I tried to aim for Fortisac's head for the extra damage, and while there are openings for it, he doesn't tend to hold it down for very long, so I switched to aiming at his tail. I guess I didn't need to aim for the weak spot after all. One more clean ankle shot and the Lich Dragon goes down. So I'm sure if you've got this far in the video, it should be exceedingly apparent that this build is disgustingly powerful. However, every time I go to a boss fight, I don't get to show how truly destructive it can be. This is mostly because the attack speed has a slow startup for the maximum damage, and most bosses aren't just gonna stand there and take it. But what if they did? Well, conveniently, there is one late game boss that will stand there and take it, whether he likes it or not. Goatman McSatan over here likes to do his best impression of a country mother counting down from 3 when her unruly kid doesn't listen. By itself, that's a pretty long animation, enough to get a couple normal swings in, or in my case, a fully charged Ash of War. I can add even more time if I open with Moog Shackle, and this is the result. I will admit I barely made this before he started sapping my life, but that's also because I had to reposition behind him to not get hit by his counting swings. So for anyone new to the game or struggling with late game bosses, why not brute force it? Why not AOK's Dancing Blade? Well, to be fair, it does require some setup, but still, I just downed one of the uber bosses in the game, hitless, in 4 attacks, so... The real question now is, will it work on the other super boss? I made a quick stop to grab the Opaline Bubble Tear because up until now I've just been rocking a heal with a Thorny Tear, which is not efficient as it means I either waste a heal immediately to be at full power or wait until I get hit first. Next up is True Loretta. Unfortunately, I can't one-shot her like I could the Ghostly version, but big frickin' surprise, this sword eats her for breakfast. Cool. Melania. Was I scared? No. Not at all.
I had already seen from Rinala that the weaker Regalia of Aokate is able to stagger her as they have the same poise, so in theory this should be easy. I even noticed at one point if the attack is fully charged it can knock her down, giving me some much appreciated breathing room, but this is where my hubris caught up with me because I thought maybe I could stunlock her this way. So in phase 2 I tried it, and she had other plans. Fair enough, Melania, I got greedy and paid for it, I won't do it again. Except I totally did try to do it again on my next attempt, but this time I was more prepared and didn't die immediately. Anyway, this is one of the easiest times I've ever had fighting Melania. Even without the talisman setup, this should still be a pretty easy way to cheese her. Alright, only two bosses left, is what I would like to say, but I completely forgot about Estelle. Hello, almost Estelle, I see you like to throw rocks at me. I will use these trees as cover. Oh god, the trees have forsaken me!
Estelle, we both know how this ends, so instead of fighting me, how about you just hand over your remembrance and go hang out in the cosmos or something?
Well, I tried to warn him. Okay, now actually two remain and only one of them was I unsure of, so off to fight the Snake Man, but first a rematch against Fake Smo. I'm literally so unafraid of this boss, I challenged his rollout. Anyway, Rykard. This one I was initially worried about only because of the lava. I had assumed it would stagger me out of the attack, which would mean I would never get the full combo. Maybe if I was lucky I could get the first big hit, but I wasn't sure. Then I stepped into the lava and, to my actual surprise, no stagger. It was at this moment I realized I wasn't trapped in here with the god-devouring serpent, it was trapped in here with me. My backup plan, should this have not worked, was to duplicate spinning weapon and then throw it on a few different swords with some status effects on them, namely Bleed and Frost. Why am I telling you about my backup plan if I didn't need it? Well, that's because I wanted to tell you about my backup plan, which was to use the Serpent Hunter Spear. But not any Serpent Hunter Spear, no, I wanted to use Cheat Engine to mod in a rather special version.
I had planned on modding one in with Aokate's Dancing Blade on it in hope that somehow the wind effect would still be applied and absolutely rip Rykard to pieces.
In the table I was using, I was indeed able to change the Ash of War on weapons, but I could not place Aok's Dancing Blade on anything. For that matter, I couldn't put Great Serpent Hunt on anything either. I was able to put Spinning Weapon on the spear, but when I equipped it, I just got an error message saying invalid Ashes of War have been removed from equipped weapons, and it just resets the spear to have Great Serpent Hunt. I guess FromSoft was smart enough to include a check on valid Ashes of Wars, those darn crafty tenured programmers. Oh well, Rykard down, and that just leaves one. So you might be wondering why I saved Regal Ancestor Spirit for last. It should be clear beyond a shadow of a doubt that using this weapon on him would be the same as making venison in a blender. So what's the deal? Well, you remember that holy sword I picked up a while back? Yeah, it's that. Initially, I thought to just go at him with it completely unupgraded, thinking at least then he would have a fighting chance. But then I wondered, what if I went in the complete opposite direction? That's right, I'm going to one-shot BAMBIIII. See, Regal Ancestor Spirit has a genuine weakness to fire and holy damage. He takes an increased 20% from it, so couple that with a few stat boosting items and it might be possible. First, a test. I took all of my talismans off and made sure not to drink my physic. At plus 10, my greatsword does about a third? That's not terrible. Also, this attack apparently has more than one hitbox on it, which is neat, I guess. Anyway, test number two was with the equipment I already had. The Godfrey Icon, the Shard of Alexander, the Sacred Scorpion Charm, and the Ritual Sword Talisman, plus the Holy Shroud and Crack Tear and my Physic. This time around, I did a little more than half. That's slightly less promising, but I'm not done yet. First, I go respec into 99 Faith and 42 Strength. My thought process here was that the holy damage would scale with faith, but in hindsight, I don't actually think that's the case. I did have slightly higher attack power now, but just from a glance, it shouldn't be anywhere near enough. Still, I went to test it just to see, and surprise, I was right. It does look like more, but I'm seeing a noticeable amount of red, which means the boss is very much alive. Sorta. As alive as an undead moose elk thing can be. There are a couple of things I can pick up to boost my damage even more. Firstly, over in Mount Gelmir, I grab Golden Bow, then from Liurnia, the Jellyfish Shield. So I don't really understand how the buffing system in this game works. According to the wiki, there are different categories of buffs, and you cannot apply buffs from the same category as they will overwrite the previous one. Okay, makes sense. Except I see Golden Bow and Flame grant me strength in the same category, but every glass cannon build I see uses both, so I don't really know what is right. But I do know Golden Bow and Contagious Fury are in two different categories, so it should be fine. Except I can't use it. For two reasons. One, I need one more point in dex because of course I do, but more importantly because putting the shield on your back removes the buff. For some reason, I thought it only removed the buff if you took it out of your hand by switching weapons, but no, it's just, if not in hand, no buff. Which is unfortunate because I need to either have my hand free or two-hand my weapon or to use the Ash of War, so that sucks.
At this point, I was a tiny bit worried, but still wanting to try. First, in Liurnia, I take on the Deathbird. I wanted to one-shot it too, but it decided to jump away from me, so I only did a small bit of its health. That's fine. Really, I'm not annoyed at all. Either way, it drops the Red Feathered Branch Sword, which is just better Ritual Sword, worse Red Tearstone Ring. Then I quickly grab Seppuku from the Scarab and throw it on a sword. This will be used to get myself into RTSR range, except there's one issue. I kinda commit Seppuku trying to use it. I'm not sure if the self-damage is based off of the weapon's attack power or a flat rate and I just don't have a lot of health, but that's annoying. It's fine though, I happen to know of another ability that lowers health but at a much smaller amount. From Bernal, I can pick up Assassin's Gambit, a neat little Ash of War that silences your footsteps and grants partial invisibility, neither of which I care about, I just need it to hurt me. So with all my shiny new buffs on, how much damage do I do? Well, that's depressing. To be fair, I missed a couple of the shockwaves, but I'm not sure it would have been enough. Luckily, I'm still not done. Back in Liurnia, again, I pick up everyone's favorite howl, that of Shabriri. This should stack with Golden Vow, but just before trying, I realized I actually pick up the Commander's Standards way earlier in this run. Both it and Golden Vow are considered aura buffs, so they shouldn't stack, but the Commander's Standard is 5% higher than Golden Vow, so I'm going to use that instead. So my new buffs are Godfrey Icon, Alexander Jar Shard, Sacred Scarab, Red Feathered Branch Sword, Howl of Shabriri, Commander Standard, and the Holy Shrouding Crack Tear. Will it be enough? Yes. Yes, it was. Thank you everyone for watching, and an extra special thanks to my patrons. Stay beautiful, y'all. If you enjoyed this video, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It really helps the channel out. And why not check out one of my other videos, like the one where I one-shot my way through all of Dark Souls 1. But until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow.